Hello and welcome to our third session of the day. My name is Devi Shastri and I'm a senior in the College of Health Sciences studying biomedical sciences and journalism. It is with great honor that I'm introducing you to a person I have had the distinct pleasure and amazing opportunity to work with for the past year through the O'Brien Fellowship. It was less than a year ago that I found myself alone and confused in Flint, Michigan. Backpack journalism, I told myself, as I crammed 2 days' worth of clothes and every pen and notebook I owned into a bag. There were people who had decided to invest in me and believed in me enough to plop me into the middle of a city in crisis. I was sitting at a rather desolate University of Michigan Flint food court with a $3 slice of pizza and a 100 times more expensive university-issued camera sitting on the table before me, exasperatedly trying to get through to the health officials I needed to speak with while I was in town. Suddenly, a man came and sat across from me. Frustration became annoyance as he attempted to make conversation despite my lack of interest and being on the phone. Finally, I hung up, deflated by the fact that my story was getting nowhere. I stared at the stranger in the seat before me and stared at him deadpan and issued my ultimatum. You have 5 seconds to leave before I call the police. I didn't have to say it twice. In addition to struggling with finding my sources, I now had another grievance with the world. I wondered if a male reporter would have to deal with what I just had. Could I really do what I came here to do? I picked up the phone again, and on the other end was a welcome voice of a strong woman, and luckily, my guide. Miranda's advice came at a time when I hit my low in Flint. It was not the first time I had talked to her about my struggles or my frustrations, and it certainly wouldn't be the last. But in that moment, my conversation with her emboldened me because she picked up the phone, and while I was trying to explain what I was trying to do, she did something remarkable. She didn't tell me what I should do. She trusted in the plan that I had and my capability to succeed and get the story that I was after. And I did, as you'll soon hear. But the wonderful thing that I've noticed time and time again about Miranda is that she always lifts up the people she is working with. Sometimes doing that requires a bit of tough love, but there is such immense power in working with a person who holds you to a high standard and never lets doubt lower it. She has 4 decades of experience working as a journalist, writing accountability stories about state and local government. Nearly 20 of those years were spent with the Washington Post working on stories about development, crime, and economic projects, and on occasion, challenging public officials to obtain documents they preferred to conceal. She has written for the Columbia Journalism Review, the Washingtonian, and the New York Times. Miranda has won numerous journalism awards and has taught journalism around the country and abroad. The night before I went off to Flint, I wrote a blog post inspired by the work and legacy of Nellie Bly, a journalist who changed the world of investigative reporting when she admitted herself to an asylum to secretly report on the injustices from within. In that post, I mused. I wonder if she was ever afraid to fail. The reality is that she most likely was. We all are. But fear aside, Bly still tried. She ventured into the unknown, subjecting herself to discomfort and uncertainty to bring others back to comfort with her. Through working with Miranda on our investigative pieces on transparency, I learned to do the same. Miranda taught us how to ask the tough questions, say it like it is, and hold the people who spend our tax dollars accountable. These are skills that are essential to our trade. And while we may imagine them being used by old school reporters from black and white films, smoking cigarettes, wearing press hats and slick suits, Miranda provided a strong female role model to 3 young women about to start on their careers. She proved to me time and time again that I can do as she has. And that is why it is such a pleasure to welcome her once again back to our campus. Please join me in welcoming Miranda Spivack.
Thank you, Davey, very much, and thank you to Teresa and Jenna, who were our team of female journalists. As it happened, it was sort of fortuitous that it worked out that way, but you know, it was a great dynamic. Thank you all. I want to give a special thank you to Greg Borowski, George Stanley, Aaron Coy is here, I hope, and German Bhatia, who of the Journal Sentinel, who welcomed us. We are the fourth O'Brien, and we are a little bit different, and we'll go into that later. But we did need sort of a home to work on a database that Greg actually suggested we develop at the beginning of this, and it has turned out to be quite an important part of our project. But let me tell you a little bit about the project, and then you're going to hear from the student journalists who really played a very, very important part. And as the dean said, it's really all about the students, and Triff said that too, and I think that's absolutely right. So I did work at the Washington Post for 20 years, but by the time I showed up in Milwaukee, I was not working at the Washington Post. And yet I had this project that I was really, really, I had started when I was at the Post, and I really, 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 really wanted to do. And it was all about, you might say it's about transparency at the state and local level, but actually it's about secrecy at the state and local level, because transparency in state and local government, I think, is a contradiction in terms more often than not. So I had, as a reporter and an editor at the Post, had immense problems dealing with a couple of local governments, and all my work at the Post was in state and local. And so even though I was in Washington, I was really very, very interested in working on issues in DC, Maryland, and Virginia. So there was this one particular government that was just became unbearable as far as I was concerned. Everything I asked for that was a matter of public record, you know, a piece of legislation, a bill, a contractor's contract, how much were you spending on this, how much did you pay your staff for this, you know, how many trips did you take that were paid for by somebody else. All of that should be a matter of public record, and in most states it is, at least in theory. But in practice, and this was actually Prince George's County, Maryland, in practice it was like a nightmare. And so anything I asked for, they asked me to put my request in writing, and then they took the requisite or the allowed 30 days that Maryland, which is one of the worst states, which you'll see when you see our database, 30 days to fulfill a public records request for something that they had in their drawer. So, you know, I knew a game was being played, and the game was being played because I was writing all kinds of stories about how they were spending money in questionable ways. And also, by the way, the county executive was in prison by this time. So it was a county that deserved our scrutiny, but the loyal functionaries, for lack of a better word, because you can tell how I feel about this, did everything they could to sort of block me out. And this was while I was at the Post, and we had then and still have a fantastic First Amendment lawyer, a guy named Jim McLaughlin, who, by the way, vetted the Trump video in 4 hours that was taking NBC 5 days to vet. I ran into him last week, and he said, oh yeah, we had it in the morning, and we put it up by 3 o'clock, and it's okay, we're not gonna get sued. Yeah. But anyway, he's a great lawyer, and so he helped me a lot. But it just sort of started to dawn on me that we could keep fighting these fights, and the Post had and still has a deep pocket for that kind of stuff and was willing to go the mat. But I thought, you know, this isn't just happening in Prince George's County, Maryland. This is happening elsewhere. And so I started to look around the Washington region and talk to my colleagues, and oh yeah, there was this school system, you know, where you couldn't get any information about spending or teacher salaries or delinquency rates, dropout rates. I mean, there's all this data out there, as Justin and Liz, and I'm sure Dave will also tell you, there's tons of data out there, but sometimes it's not in a very usable format. Other times it is there, but they don't want to give it to you. And other times it's on paper, like these records that Liz was talking about, and they might give it to you, but they don't really know what's in it, and they're scared to give it to you, and so the mantra becomes, when in doubt, don't give it out. And then, so I started looking around the region. Anyway, I left the Post, and I still had this burning desire to write about this, and so when I came out here in, what was it, 2015, I guess we were all here, and talking about this project, I was a last minute applicant, which Herb could tell you. He was like, who are you and how come we haven't heard from you? And it was because I had not heard about the fellowship, actually. But anyway, so what ended up happening is we got a sort of different arrangement, but what I got out of that was I was going to do this piece for Columbia Journalism Review and for the Center for Public Integrity, which I'll show you, and then I'm now doing 5 related pieces with the help of these folks for the Center for Investigative Reporting, which is actually something I think the O'Brien should think about. You have 3 traditional news organizations here, and that's what you've had every year, actually, as far as I can tell. And hey, I am a product of a traditional news organization, and I'm all for it, and I'm all for their continued success. But there's a lot of other stuff out there now to think about. And so luckily for me, I sort of, with this grant money and some other grant money, hooked on with the Center for Investigative Reporting, which is run by Robert Rosenthal, who is well known in journalism circles and, you know, fantastic editors. And they're, so we're doing the rest of the stories for them. So that's all really good. But anyway, it's all been sort of an interesting adventure, and so I want to start with just showing you a little video about why do we care about transparency. I mean, I've given you some of it, but you need to see some more. So we'll start with that. And this is, by the way, not a video I created, for the record. It's from something called the Open Government Partnership, which is an international consortium funded by big donors like Pierre Omidyar, who's the eBay guy, and George Soros, who is Open Society, and then European governments are part of this. It's a very interesting little video. See if you can see if it's useful to you. And then, you know, I think since police accountability is just a huge issue right now around the country, and thank God for the iPhone is all I can say, that, you know, 5 years ago we would not have had any way to cross-check information that the police officer wrote a report and it was untrue. You know, there wasn't a lot of way to refute that other than the other person's testimony, who might be a drug dealer or some other person who doesn't have a lot of credibility. The iPhone has changed that, but also the fact that police are now wearing video cameras and using dash cameras should make things more open and accountable. But the reality is that there are 20 states now that have passed laws that limit the accessibility of these videos. And, you know, police will often say it's part of an ongoing investigation, they can't release it, and that is one of the exemptions under practically every state's Freedom of Information law. But, you know, you saw this in Tulsa, you saw a really interesting contrast in Tulsa and in North Carolina just in the last couple weeks, where the Charlotte police chief was just in, you know, all knotted up about should I give out the video, shouldn't I give out the video. It took them days, you know, there were riots, there's a lot of lack of trust. Tulsa, with another police shooting, they released the video right away and they moved quickly. But that's a whole other area of the law where actually things are, you know, new technology should help us, but there is such a reaction to it. So that's just sort of another area where why should we care? We should care because these tools should make things more transparent and accountable, but then the legislatures come along and pass laws because of pressure from various areas to close that down. So that's actually a very interesting issue to watch over the next year, is how much of that's going to get written into state FOIA law, Freedom of Information laws, because it's half the states almost now are making it less accessible. So we worked, by the way, remotely. So the first thing we did as a group was, I was in Washington and the students were here, and we had a Skype meeting every week that they set up, and everybody showed up for and on time, which was always very impressive. And the first task for the whole first semester, the students had to develop information about every single state and DC's Freedom of Information law, because, as you'll see in a moment, we've developed this comparative database that we hope actually will be useful to what I call civilians, for lack of a better word, non-journalists. You know, this is not just a whining journalist problem about transparency, but the fact is, this is the media is constricting more and more and more of these Information Act requests. The majority of them are by businesses anyway, but more and more are now by, you know, regular residents who want information and are having trouble getting it from the government. So we were actually developing, I think, what will amount to a toolkit for every single state. So I want to show you that. And that was developed with the great good graces of the Journal Sentinel. I can't say enough to thank George and his colleagues. And that George let them do it. I mean, that was just fabulous. So let me find that. Oh, boy. Here we go. All right. So this is what we have developed.
Can you expand
that? Yeah. So, and this is not live yet, but it will be very soon. So you want to, let's look at Wisconsin. So, which George can, I mean, this was ground zero for closed government about a year and a half ago, and thank God for editorials in the Journal Sentinel and elsewhere, but Scott Walker, right before he ran for president, did this, like, 11th hour secret move to clamp down on transparency in the state. And this state actually has had a pretty good reputation, much more transparent than Maryland. I think the time for a response in Wisconsin is 5 to 10 days, is that right? I can't even remember, but as opposed to Maryland, which is 30 days, so that just tells you something. But anyway, let's see what we can do here. Okay. So these women, who probably had not read a law before this class, if I had to guess, I never asked them, so I'm making an assumption, had to read every single statute and try to answer a bunch of questions about the statute so we could then decide what information we wanted for the database. Now, they're going to look at this and they're going to say, we answered many more questions than that, and that is true. I have more data that we haven't yet totally vetted, but there will be more. This is just the beginning. But anyway, let's look at Wisconsin. So the first question is, well, I don't know why that's an act. Okay, so in Wisconsin, to respond to a public records request, the law says as soon as practicable, and I think in reality it's a few days usually here. And that's actually not a bad standard. It would be nice if it said 3 days, but you know, you can't always hope for that. But, you know, in Maryland, as I said, it's 30 days. I mean, that is just a joke as far as if you were writing a story with some urgency, which I, of course, was doing all the time, 30 days is impossible to deal with, you know? So, okay, so that was one of the questions we're answering. Is there a limit on how much an agency can charge to fulfill a records request? That's really a big deal in this arena. In Montgomery County, Maryland, where I live, a local government there wanted to charge somebody $58,000 for records about a library. I mean, that's the kind of crazy stuff that goes on. And they think they can justify that by saying, oh, it's going to take us that long to go through all these paper records that we have. You know, my feeling is take that $58,000 and digitize your records, please. How to appeal. This is a big problem. Most states, you got to go to court. So right away, if you get turned down for an open records request and you want that information and you're not a journalist with a deep, you know, lawyer behind you, you got to go to court, and that's very expensive. And so a lot of these denials end right there. People just can't go on with it. You want information about your public school. You want information about, you know, what your city council is doing. I mean, if they turn you down, many states, you got to go to court. Now, Wisconsin has the attorney general, which is different from a lot of states, can intervene in this. And so sometimes it's not as costly here. Who can request records? This is really fascinating to me. In 2013, the US Supreme Court, in a unanimous ruling, go figure, how could they be unanimous about this, said in a Virginia case that if Virginia only wanted to make its records available to Virginia citizens, citizens, that was okay. Forget interstate commerce. Forget all these other clauses in the Constitution that I would think are very important. The Supreme Court, and that's with Ruth Bader Ginsburg and Stephen Breyer. I'm like, what were they thinking? That was a unanimous ruling. A lot of states have a restriction on who can get the records. Crazy, right? And as I said, a lot of these record requests are from businesses. They're not from journalists. So this is really, this is a chilling effect on commerce. But anyway, so this is another one, and I've done a whole separate story on this, trade secrets. Trade secret should have a very firm definition. Wisconsin doesn't allow trade secrets to be made public. I can tell you, if you ask for a contract, you're not going to get most of it because they're going to say, oh, there's proprietary information in there, it's a trade secret. And they will invoke that over anything. And not only that, they'll let the company decide what a trade secret is and black it out. So, you know, the state is ceding a lot of power when they do that. And so that, you know, also clamps down on information. And then we have the fines. Is there a penalty? You could look at these penalties. I mean, actually, Wisconsin's a little better than some states. $100 to, you know, an agency that doesn't... in Maryland, the regents had all these secret meetings. The University of Maryland had all these secret meetings when they wanted to go into the Big Ten. And we all know what a great idea that was for Maryland football, not. But anyway, they had to pay a $100 penalty because they had that, in this case, it was open meetings. But, I mean, that's a joke. That's not a deterrent for most of these guys. Anyway, and then we have a link to the statute. So there you go. That's this fabulous database. Thank you to the Journal Sentinel. Let me just throw up on the screen these two stories that we have published so far. And as I said, there are more to come very soon. So the first one I did almost a year ago, which was I participated in something that the Center for Public Integrity, which is another one of these news nonprofits in Washington, did. And they ranked every state on a bunch of issues, including transparency. And so I participated in that. And then in the spring, and this is the story that I had sort of come to Marquette and said, this is what I want to do. So I did it. In the spring, where is that one? Okay, here it is. So this was a case, this was sort of a merging of the decline in journalism. I'm sorry to talk about that. And because I know Tris said everybody's really negative about the industry, and I'm a big believer in the industry, but I also know it's struggling. Anyway, this was a story about a community on the eastern shore of Maryland where it has a very small newspaper that used to be actually a great, aggressive small newspaper, but times have changed. And so this was all about a community where the residents certainly had to learn to do what the journalists used to do, and had to learn to make use of the open records laws, the open meetings laws, whatever. And this was about a community that somebody wanted to come in and build these wind turbines, which are, you know, these massive windmills, which, by the way, I discovered would be as tall as the Washington Monument. That's how big they are. So it's a very flat piece of land, beautiful community. They didn't want it, and they had to figure out how to fight it. So that was that story. So now I'm going to hand it off to my colleagues here. Teresa is going to go first. And by the way, another difference between our project and others is that I didn't get a travel allowance, so they went out on their own and did a fabulous job.
All right, well, thank you, Miranda. So Miranda talked a little bit about our project and how it was kind of distance learning. And I know that that had complications maybe in some ways, but for me it worked out really well because I happened to be a distance student a lot of the time. So for me it was great.
Yeah.
And so, of course, as you guys have learned in listening to Miranda, of course, Miranda comes to journalism with a transparency perspective and a transparency angle. And I happen to look at things and come to journalism with a different angle. I kind of come to it through an ecological perspective. So I found early on that my challenge with this project was trying to put these two things together. And in trying to use what Miranda is curious about and knows very well and put that together with some ecological issues. So that's what I did. So as Miranda also shared with you, the way that we started out is, you know, doing our data crunching and going, I guess there were four students
the
at
fall.
The beginning. And we split up the 50 states, as Miranda said, in Washington, D.C. So we each had about a dozen states, and we went to their websites and started to create a catalog, which is what has turned into the soon-to-be-published database that you guys were looking at there. So we did that for the first semester. And then the second semester, we got to kind of delve into our own personal stories and projects. And so, of course, you know, I was looking for this ecology project. I'm interested, you know, in this region, the Great Lakes around here, but I'm also very interested in the West, where I spend a lot of my time. I got my bachelor's degree in biology from the University of San Francisco, which is also Jesuit. So talking to Miranda, you know, having a spiral of ideas all over the place, and she had the idea of trains and train incidents. And as many of you know that follow journalism, oil trains have become pretty big in the media recently. And there have also been a number of train accidents that have involved spills in this region along the upper Mississippi River. So I got to do some traveling for my reporting, which was great. I got to travel to the upper Sacramento River, and I also traveled to the upper Mississippi River. And so looking for some personal stories here in connection with these spills and, you know, hoping also to possibly unravel some ways in which the ecology, the ecosystem, other species, the plant life, the animal life could be affected by these spills, but then how this all comes back to transparency. So it's tricky, and I'm still kind of struggling with it, but it's been fun. So let's see, we'll run through this Weebly website that I made. So I hope to publish this story eventually. I've been working with Greg, and Greg has been great to work with me as a student journalist for the last 2 years in this fellowship. So I guess my big question is chemical spills into rivers and whether the government is transparent about these spills. And so this image here is one that I took when I was on the Wisconsin side of the upper Mississippi River. You can see this train track here right along the river. And it just so happens that in my time spent up there, there are train tracks everywhere. They're going along the sides, the banks of the rivers. They're crossing over the rivers. And the train traffic was just incredible. It seemed like every 5 minutes. There's a train. And with all this train traffic, one would think, and actually we've documented that there are a lot of incidents and oftentimes chemical spills in these areas. So the Journal Sentinel and other local news agencies have documented and reported on many of these spills. So about a year ago, last November, 18,000 gallons of ethanol spilled into the upper Mississippi River, and that was from the Wisconsin side. So of course, you know, the upper Mississippi River borders several different states. Minnesota, Iowa, Illinois is discussed here as well. But of course, downriver, the Mississippi travels through many, many different states as it makes its way down to the ocean. So some other recent train accidents in 2015 was one near Wahpeton, Iowa, and another near Galena, Illinois. And then most recently in 2016, 850 gallons of vegetable oil spilled into the river from the Minnesota side in the upper Mississippi River as well. And there was another big accident on the West Coast just a few months ago, and that was when 42,000 gallons of crude oil spilled into the Columbia River Gorge in Oregon. So clearly these spills are happening all over the place, and there are many different chemicals that are seeping into the ecosystem that can obviously affect humans, but can also affect, you know, the waterways, anything downstream from the spills as these chemicals travel along with the water that's moving out towards the ocean. So now connecting back to transparency, well, who's keeping track of all of this? Is anyone documenting the spills, the amount, the number of chemicals that are going into these waterways? And what about the ways that they could be affecting people immediately and in the long term as well? So a lot of big questions, as you can see. So it turns out there is a federal database that documents these spills. And this database is run by the U.S. Coast Guard. It's the National Response Center database, and it's used by many different agencies throughout the country. So the EPA is one of the federal agencies that responds upon a report to this database, and several other local governments can use this information as well. So what happens when there's a spill, let's say it's in the upper Mississippi River, someone has to call that in, and it's legally obligated to do so. They write all this down, they put it into this database, which is available to each and every one of us, but then it doesn't seem like it's ever updated. No one ever goes back to it, and as a result, there are a lot of holes in the database. And so in speaking with the EPA, with the Coast Guard, with other local governments, it seems like this information doesn't really live anywhere else. It's broken up in different places, but there's no other place other than this database, which is publicly available, that is supposed to hold all this information. So this is where we tried to draw some of our information. So let's see, I'm gonna go down here first. All right, and so using this database, we tried, well, what I really wanted to do is I wanted to extract the total amount of chemicals that were seeping into these different waterways. So I chose the upper Sacramento River and the upper Mississippi River, and I found this was completely impossible because they so often don't update these numbers. But I was paired with one of the interns at the Journal Sentinel, and she's a much more experienced data person than I was, but she was able to extract some numbers from the database. So we decided that we could not figure out how many gallons of chemicals were leaking into the ecosystem, but what we could document with a bit of trust was the actual number of spills into these areas. And so you can see here a 25-year trend. So from 1991, using this database, to present to 2015. And we were looking at the entire river. We weren't really able to classify different segments, upper Mississippi versus upper Sacramento. But you can see here that the upper Mississippi River completely just blows away the number of spills into our river as opposed to the Sacramento. Of course, there are a lot of differing aspects of these rivers that you have to take into account, but I still think it's interesting and telling of something, maybe. Let's see. So in going through all this, we found that there is an immense transparency issue going on here that I'm still trying to tease through a little bit. I have some maps here because I did spend some time on the Upper Mississippi as well as the Upper Sacramento River. And I wanted to show some photographs that I took and some of the people that I met and spoke to along the Upper Sacramento River in a town called Dunsmuir, which is a pretty small town. And the reason I went up there is because there was a very traumatic ecological disaster there 25 years ago in which a train went off this track that you can see pictured here and spilled, let's see, probably have the amount. I guess I have the amount elsewhere.
Tens of thousands.
Tens of thousands of gallons of a pesticide into the river. And it just so happened to kill everything in the river from the place where it spilled to a larger lake where the chemical could finally disperse. So all the fish, all the trees along the river, all the mollusks, all the shelled organisms, everything, amphibians in the river. And so I'll just share some of my photographs that I took there. All right, so that's the city. You can see the train on one of their buildings. You can see the train track behind the river. Hardware store where I met an individual I interviewed who was great. You can see the mountains. One of the individuals, Rich, who spoke with me. Another person, Naomi, who spoke with me. And then Wayne, who's a fisherman in the Upper Sac. And so when I was in Northern California, I spoke with some locals that had some memories of the spill 25 years ago, and I also spoke with some government officials. One of the complications, of course, was that this is a historical incident, and so it included a lot of memories. And so I spoke with a few individuals from the California Department of Fish and Wildlife who were there at the time of the spill. They shared some memories and also some pictures. So you can actually see these photographs taken in 1991 of this pesticide that went downriver and also brought with it a toxic gas that billowed downriver, the green plume, as many described it. And so I'll introduce you here to some of the individuals that I spoke with who I hope become a part of my story in the future. So one was Naomi Croft, who is an interesting older woman who brought me into her house. She told me a lot of things. She shared a lot about her life with me. But she said that she heard a loud crash in her memory of the spill and that all of a sudden it turned green outside. So that was one of her memories. So this is Rich Weir, who was a really nice gentleman, and I've continued to speak with both of them on the phone recently. And Rich said, no one ever knocked on our door, and he definitely felt like the government was trying to avoid letting the locals know about this incident that occurred 25 years ago, but right after the spill happened. And then this was a fisherman who is really wonderful, Wayne Eng. And he bought a house right next to the river a few months before the spill happened, but was out of town at the time of the spill. So he was lucky in some ways, but came back a few years later, right after the fish populations rebounded, and then began guiding fishing trips right after that. So for him, it worked out really well. But he said it's just a matter of time until there's another spill in his precious fishing grounds. And he said it's kind of like that volcano. It's sleeping, but it's going to pop. So that kind of brings about our relevance today and how it comes back to the issues around here. So, yeah, great. That's all.
Thanks, Teresa. Very good. So next up is Jenna Ebbers, and she did some work on police, which is actually one of the next stories that I'm doing is on police accountability. So some of her work will get incorporated into that, but she also has a video and a few other things to show you. She's a graduate. No, it's okay. She's already graduated. But we still have her here. Yeah, very for you.
Hi, everybody. My name is Jenna Ebbers, and I graduated from Marquette this past May. When I originally began this project, I had an intention to bring to life the conflict that the public faces with wanting transparency from the police departments, as well as wanting privacy themselves. And it was a pretty tough process, but I'm proud to say that I think I accomplished my goal, and you will see the article and the video that I created. So after some diligence with sourcing and hassling public relations personnel, as you know, is journalist's job in the beginning, I was able to arrange interviews with a few members of the Milwaukee Police Department, including Chief Edward Flynn, who was by far one of my best interviewees. Chief Flynn allowed me to help put a human face to police departments and their opinions on this issue of transparency and secrecy. So the process leading up to my interviews was very hard because, one, I found out not many people want to talk to a young student journalist who is unassociated with a news organization at the moment. And it was also really difficult to find the right contacts as we were looking to interview other sides to the story, including community voices. We did get one alternative opinion, so you'll see that as well. But the help was limited as I only had one PR contact at the police department, and he was a sergeant himself. And he was really great after I finally got him to talk to me, and he helped set up everything. And I was able to talk to multiple police chiefs, or not chiefs, officers, as well as one of the records keepers in the police department who works with the body camera footage. And he was able to talk to me about the creation of the policy, as well as the editing system that they use to ensure that people's rights under the Constitution and under the privacy laws are able to be withheld from being open record while still giving everything that the community needs from this footage. So my experience interviewing the police staff was very intimidating. It was exciting, and it was very interesting walking through the sensors through the doors with bags of camera footage as I was videotaping my interviews. And I was prepared with about two full sheets of questions, and they were so conversational and great in their interviews that I didn't even get to all of them. So I am going to show the video that is the result of multiple interviews.
We are either invading people's privacy, you know, without any cause at all, or refusing to hold ourselves accountable and share that information with the general public. Right? You know, it's whatever move you make in either direction, somebody is going to be furious with you. I'd say on balance, the great mass of people that clump slightly left or slightly right or firmly in the middle see it as a useful accountability tool.
The system that we have is a two-piece unit. We have what's called the battery pack here. This is the on and off switch. It's connected to the camera system via wire, which runs up to my camera. The camera itself runs about 9.5 hours worth of footage from start to finish, so that I can, you know, control it on and off. So simply start the video, I tap it twice. You can hear that tone that lets me know that, in fact, it's on now. There's also a LED light that flashes to let me know it's on as well. And then to stop it, I just simply hold it down for 3 to 5 seconds. And that long tone lets me know it's now off.
They're excellent tools for gathering evidence. They are certainly seen as the office by the officers as something that will protect them from false allegations. And they have also found that once they tell somebody that they're wearing a body camera, it's a way to diffuse situations that otherwise might present more of a challenge to them once that person knows their behavior is being documented. It's fair to say the police will be the most documented workers in the world when this is all over. We're moving ahead with it and certainly see far more advantages than disadvantages.
The way I kind of explain it to the class is, you know, we have our baton, we have our firearms, we have our oleo resin capsicum, which is like mace. Now we have body cameras, we've had in-car video systems. Each one kind of serves their own piece into helping, you know, put together the puzzle. And you start taking away those various pieces, and now you got gaps to fill. And now you kind of make a big jump from one to the other. All the technology has a limitation. In-car video is great for some things, but it's not so great, you know, when you get away from the car. Body cameras, a little different story. It goes with you. They see pretty much what the police are seeing for the most part, and we can only benefit from it.
I raised the issue that we certainly weren't opposed to it. And for us, there are more advantages than disadvantages, but even then I cautioned that we intervene in the most intimate and sensitive times in people's lives sometime. And I'm not entirely sure that everybody wants that documented or theoretically subject to a public records request. You know, you're going to see, you know, lots of random shots and sounds of people grunting and sweating, but you're not necessarily going to get the perfect overview of all the elements of the confrontation. So it's not going to be perfection. Every time there's a new technology, there are new problems. It doesn't matter what it is. There's no technological way to guarantee public trust in the police.
So I want to pinpoint that one of my favorite parts of my interview with Chief Flynn was when he compared the footage that you get from the body cameras to the NFL instant replay. And he acknowledged that community members are disappointed in the limited amount of visuals that you get through this footage and the lack of realization that these cameras are on their shoulders or their headpieces, so they are very close to the person that they are engaging with, and there has been a lot of controversy about that as well. So that was just really interesting to me for that joke that he made. Along with this interview experience, I was able to sit in on a body camera class that they were holding at the police department at the time. And there were about 20 police officers in this class, and they were learning about the system that they use to upload all of their footage from their body cameras. So the body cameras hold about 9 hours of footage at once, and then it would need to be uploaded to the system, which fortunately for the police officers is just over about the length of a shift. So as they were learning about this, they seemed a little frustrated as well, and it was very interesting to see how much their opinions swayed about this. Many of them decided that they did want this because they have had incidents where they had someone kind of negate one of their reports, and they see it as crucial evidence that they are being truthful. And the other ironic part of this is that their system is called evidence.com, which Christopher Amody, who is part of the
ACLU.
Yeah, he's part of the ACLU. He is one of my alternative opinions, and he said that he thinks it's very controversial that their system is called evidence.com, because he does not believe that it should be considered evidence. It should only be considered truthfulness. So to talk about the actual internship and fellowship experience, I think for a student experience, we got the most independent journalism experience that we could have had, especially for a student internship. We were able to kind of come up with these stories off of the main topic, and Miranda was so helpful and motivating with what we really saw the project becoming. Being so independent, because she was working remotely, it forced me to carry myself differently, and I had to also make sure that I was being taken seriously, which was a little hard as a 5'6 blonde girl walking into the Milwaukee Police Department. But I definitely think that this project turned out great. I am very happy with where we came from it, and I think that it shows the truthfulness of the issues with body cameras and the secrecy that is what police are facing right now in the nation.
Great. Thank you. Okay, and next is Davey, who you've already heard from a little bit and hear from some more. And we sent Davey to Flint, Michigan by herself. She wasn't even, she'll tell you this, wasn't even old enough to rent a hotel room by herself. But Marquette did a workaround.
Yeah, so I'm realizing that I am the baby of the group. I'm still here at Marquette. I'm doing O'Brien again this year, working with Mark Johnson from the Journal Sentinel. So that's very cool that as a junior, I was given the opportunity to go to a city I've never been to for 2 days and try to figure it out, which is essentially what I did. So kind of some background on me and my story. Yeah, we can start with this one, yeah. Okay. This is AC Dumas. I met him at a town hall in Flint, standing in front of all of their water bottles that they had to give out to everyone after the town hall was completed. So I am in the College of Health Sciences, as I already mentioned earlier. I am studying biomedical sciences and journalism, and I have a minor in neuroscience, and I'm aspiring to be a science writer. So when I got chosen for the project on transparency, my first thought was, how do I make this work so I can still keep learning about science writing along with learning about transparency? And that was kind of an interesting angle to look at it through, because it turns out that there are these transparency issues everywhere and in every kind of portion of our lives. And so it was very cool to finally narrow in on this Flint water crisis as my topic and then try to understand how I was going to figure out if there was any transparency issue beyond the obvious ones that were already being reported on by everyone and their mother in the media. And that was the big difficulty in this project, is we kept trying to find an angle that hasn't been covered as much. And so what we ended up looking at was this idea that there is a database. So the law is that everyone, in Michigan at least, everyone who is aged 1 to 2, or at least before they are 6 years old, should have their blood tested for lead levels. The reason for this age is that they're younger, they're starting to crawl around and like touching things and putting things in their mouth, and they're getting household lead exposure through lead dust or lead paint. So these blood levels are all being documented amongst the children who are under Medicaid. So we thought, well, if these numbers are being taken, how was it possible that the Flint people were poisoned for over a year and no one noticed a spike? And it turns out that the reason for this is because all of the data is consolidated by the CDC and then on the state level. But because the funding for this surveillance system, this lead blood level surveillance system, has been decimated over the past few years, there are not enough people to keep track of the data, to go through the data and analyze it. And it's very easy for something to slip through if someone sees a report and says, oh, there was a weird spike, but then discredits it, which is actually, now there's a lawsuit underway claiming that that is what happened. So I started looking into this, the history of this system, why the funding was cut. It was very odd. It was cut and then combined with asthma and given half the funding that it normally got. By itself, both asthma and lead were given $15 million out of the $30 million that used to be for lead alone. And when you look at those numbers, it's really obvious that if we're collecting all of this data and we're trying to keep track of the trends of these blood levels of children, of course there's not going to be enough people to keep track of it. Another thing that we ran into was this issue that this local health department only gets an elevated blood level. So if an elevated blood level is at the level of 5, if anyone tests under 5, then the local department is not paying attention to that on a smaller, more on the ground level. And because of this, a lot of things were being slipped through if suddenly a lot of people have 4, 3, 2, 1 levels. But it is known that there's no safe level of lead. So that is kind of the transparency issue that I began to look into and investigate. And then I went to Flint.
Here. Right. Is that this one?
Yeah. Yeah, it's that one. Yeah, so this is what the story ended up being, and it's still under edits and a lot of things. But I was told that I had the opportunity to go to Flint and that I could if I wanted to, so I said yes. And I got on a plane and I went for 2 days. I stayed in a hotel 2 days, 3 nights, and like tried not to freak out the whole time because I was kind of freaking out. And the scary part was I set up. It was hard to get in touch with people in Flint because they're dealing with a crisis, they're dealing with a lot of problems, and I don't know who lives there in terms of the personal stories that I wanted to get. And so a lot of it was stuff that I needed to figure out once I got there. So I had one interview set up with someone from the health department when I actually arrived, and I got to my hotel, threw my stuff down, and the people at the hotel were actually super nice, and they drove me into the city and dropped me off, and I had no idea where I was or what I was doing. And I went and did my first interview in, like, the first 20 minutes. And then I ended up sitting in the University of Flint's food court, like, freaking out and trying to figure out what to do. Because it was very hard to find someone to talk to who was a resident, because Flint is a very kind of, like, quiet town. There aren't a lot of people living there. They're all in their homes. It's not very bustling, hustling, bustling kind of a city. And they're dealing with a lot of issues when it comes to poverty and violence. And so I was trying to keep track of what area is safe to go to, what area is not safe to go to. And through all of this, I was talking with Miranda, I was talking to Professor Lowe, calling, and trying to figure things out. And I remember sitting down having one conversation with Miranda about how I had just luckily stumbled upon the fact that the mayor was having a town hall that night in a local high school gym. And so I picked up all my stuff and I went to the town hall, and that's where I got all of my sources, that's where I talked to several of the very high-profile people involved in the Flint community, and I set up a lot of interviews from then. But I remember Miranda telling me later that night, that she said, the best reporters have the best luck. And so that was kind of my little takeaway from that whole trip, was like, I have a lot of good luck on my side, and a lot of things worked out. So I had the opportunity to talk to a lot of people. A lot of people let me into their homes, and I guess this is not going to work, but yeah. So I had the chance to go into a lot of people's homes and see how they were living. Just like piles and piles of water bottles, people who have to test their water every day, or I mean every week, and send it in to make sure that there is still not a lead issue. This woman I spoke to, she let me into her home. She told me about how she had diabetes, and she didn't know if her headaches were happening because of the lead or because of diabetes, and she didn't know how to get tested because there isn't a lot of communication about these things. Everyone was given a water filter, but there's also a huge limitation on that, because they only have one water filter per home, or they only give one cart of water bottles per day to everyone. These are two health department officials I spoke to who were putting together a countywide massive screening day. It's a local church member where the screening was going to be held. Just many, 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 many people who lived there and who were trying to get through the crisis. This was the town hall. That's Admiral Dunwoody. She was sent there by President Obama to take care of the situation, boots on the ground. I had the opportunity to talk to her briefly. This is the Mayor Karen Weaver. And everyone is just angry, like that woman, which is understandable because you were poisoned by, and you handed this poison water to your children. So of course they were upset, but it was so cool to see this community work to rebound. So another interesting interview I had was with this family. They let me into their home. This is Joy Jones. She is a mother of five, and they're all under the age of 10. And it was so powerful to sit down with them and talk to them about what this crisis has been like for them. She noticed that her kids had a lot of health problems. She noticed her dog had a lot of health problems. It was just adding on, and she couldn't figure out what it was until she found out that it was because the water was had the lead in it. And like talking to them, I think, was the most impactful thing, seeing these kids who we don't know what the impact of the lead will be on their development because it's different for everyone. And so we don't know how they will grow up or what their life will be like or if they will face any difficulties because of this. But there are studies that have linked this lead exposure to increased crime and violence. And so this is going to have a huge impact on the community. So that's what I ended up doing my story on, was why this surveillance system failed, despite the fact that it existed and despite the fact that people had the data at their disposal, and yet it was missed. So I just wanted to talk a little bit about, I guess, my experience with the O'Brien internship. It was amazing. We learned a lot, I think, on how to communicate differently because we were working remotely. And through that, like Jenna said, we did have a lot of independence. And that's why I was able to write this 3,000-word story about the Flint water crisis on my own. And it was very, very cool to have the opportunity to do that. I don't think a lot of people would get that opportunity at my age, I think. Like Miranda said, they wouldn't even let me have the hotel room. Professor Lowe called and fought with them because you have to be 21 to be in a hotel by yourself, apparently. I guess they didn't want me to drink their alcohol or something. I don't know. So it was I guess that shows the impact of this. I was young, and I still am, and I'm still starting out. And so having this opportunity to just go to the city and talk to people and do this research and write this story, I told Miranda over coffee while we were talking about what we were going to say at this that I was so stressed writing this story. It was the biggest thing I've ever done. I would sit there for hours, and my shoulders would tense up, and then I'd send it to her, and then I'd be like, I can't feel my shoulders, and relax would come over me once I sent it, because it was a big undertaking. But I learned so much from it. I still am learning from it. We learned how to deal with the CDC, even though we were asking them all these questions that they definitely didn't want me asking them, and they never actually got back with us with a statement of why this funding was cut. And so I learned a lot about that and how to stand up for myself and prove to people that I am someone they should be talking to, because I think it was Jenna said that we weren't affiliated with a news organization per se. And it's a lot of explaining that goes into what we're trying to do. But being patient, and I think the biggest thing I took away from this is if you want to write about transparency, you have to be transparent. And I
went to Flint, and the first cold call I made was to some local church elder. Her name was Sarah Bailey. And I was on the phone with her for 2 hours, but she spent the first 20 minutes just like ripping me apart because she didn't know who I was. She said, "Who are you? What are you doing here? Why are you calling me? Like, these people are coming in from the government and from the news organizations and from all over the country, and they're descending upon our city, and we're already struggling, and we don't need one more of you." And I was very taken aback by that. I was very shocked, and I like took a step back and said, "Okay, like, if you want to write about transparency, you have to be transparent." And so I said, "Can I please start over? Can I please tell you what I'm trying to do, and then you can decide if you want to talk to me or not?" And that worked, and I explained to her every single thing I was trying to do, but that was a big lesson for me. And I think that this opportunity just was unparalleled. I'm so excited to be working again with the fellowship this year, with the chance to do it as independently as I think our team did, was really, really remarkable. And I think it took, I think our team is very strong. I think it took a lot of trust, because when Miranda's in DC and I'm over here, she needs to be able to trust me to get the job done, and I need to be able to trust her. And I think that we developed really strong relationships that way too. So that was my experience.
Great.
Thank you.
Thanks. Very nice. So I will just briefly say one thing, and then we'll take some questions. So the question you may want to know is, what's next for this project? There are 5 stories on the runway with the Center for Investigative Reporting. 2 of them are in and copy edited, and that coupled with the database, they should be published imminently. And then these other pieces will be, if not, and I think some of them will be standalone pieces and some may be incorporated. So that's what's happening next. And I was able to get more funding, so I got some money from the City University of New York, a fund put together by Richard Ravitch, who's the former Lieutenant Governor of New York, very interested in government budgeting issues, so did something about procurement and contracting. And I'm actually now the Pulliam Visiting Distinguished Professor of Journalism at DePauw University, teaching one class a semester, which gives me a lot of time and a lot of money to finish this project. So it has a very happy ending, and Marquette certainly helped along the way, and I'm very grateful to that. So what questions do you have? Because I know we need to move along.
Nobody. Oh, no.
Liz will bail us out.
You had mentioned very early on the time frame, the large time windows that some of these agencies have to give info. And PA is one of those terrible states where they can take something like 35 days. I'm curious in your reporting whether you ran around or encountered anybody who found some creative ways to get around this or to challenge the time frame issue.
You know, that's a good question. I didn't find that. I don't know if anybody else did. I mean, mostly, even though I spent the beginning of this conversation sort of mocking government, and by the way, my husband is a lawyer for the federal government, so I shouldn't be too ungrateful, but one of the big problems actually is paper records. It's records they don't know where it is. It's not sometimes deliberate obstructionism, although there is some of that. It's often we're overwhelmed by data, the data systems haven't caught up. Government hasn't spent, because of all this anti-government spending, they haven't spent money to get their data systems up to snuff. I mean, as somebody said, somebody said earlier that there were computers, or there were things that were using software systems. You said that, using software systems that were built before she was born. I mean, that's pathetic. But so, no, I haven't found any workarounds. And usually it's the opposite, which is they'll take longer and they can ask for extensions to respond to your requests. And you know, we didn't even talk about open meetings very much. That's another part of this database. And that's another big problem. But anyway, so no, I don't have a happy answer to your question. Anybody else? No?
No, thank you.
Okay, thank you very much.